Guys, Dragline Dynamics is almost here. I told you guys it would happen, and it is happening, thanks to you. We are almost at the point where I'm ready to start a laboratory specifically built around the perfection of web shooters and other super technologies. Hopefully by now you've seen that I'm serious about the science behind it. We're going to need a bit more help to get it started. Specifically, we're looking at a few machines that will help us upgrade this product, the concealable web shooter built into a watch, and make it available for you to purchase, alongside the web fluid that we will be perfecting continuously. These machines include a few 3D printers, some shop tools, a CNC, and I'm looking at parts to make a fume hood so I can stay safe while perfecting chemical processes. That's why, in order to help us get this next-gen web shooter off the ground, I've decided to let all of you make this fan favorite classic of mine. From one of my best performing videos in recent years, all 3D printable SDL files are available on my Patreon for just $5, alongside a detailed list of commercial parts. So pitch in $5 to help us get this one-of-a-kind laboratory up and running, and you could build one of the best performing fluid web shooters out there. In this video, I'll show you how to make it once you've purchased the files. Remember, this money isn't for me, it's for funding scientific progress. That being said, please enjoy the tutorial.
So first of all, like I said, all of the parts are in the STL file available to patrons of $5 or more. Once you download these parts, you're going to want to print all of them using your best print settings. I'm going to assume you figured that out by now. You don't need too much accuracy for these parts. You might want to go towards 0.2 millimeter layer height, or whatever you or your printer is comfortable with. So assuming you have all the parts printed, the first thing to do is to attach the left and right strap pivots to the lower body. This can be achieved through the two countersunk 832 UNC screws and the two 832 UNC hex nuts that I've listed in the commercial parts list. The attachment is fairly straightforward. Once that's done, it's time to attach the four M2.5 heatset inserts into the lower body. These heatset inserts will be used to attach the upper body using M2.5 screws. The technique for attaching the heatset inserts is fairly straightforward as well, but a little more complicated, especially if you've never done it before. Take an insert, place it into one of the four holes designated, take the soldering iron, and press down on the top of the heatset insert lightly until it heats up enough such that it can simply melt its way into the hole. Once you take the soldering iron away, it should be firmly attached. Do this for all four heatset inserts, and now you're ready for the next step. The next thing you're going to do is prepare the valve stem. This is a very interesting part. I've done a lot of research on it in recent years to try to optimize it to increase the flow rate of the web shooter. This version you see here is simply an extended version of the original design by the Human Spider. Now, both the Human Spider and I have found best results with this part when it's printed using stereolithography. By that we mean these special photopolymerization printers that you may have seen that solidify resin using light. Now, these have the capability to largely decrease the surface roughness that 3D printing is traditionally associated with. And we've seen that this largely prevents the web fluid from bonding to this component, which is crucial to prevent clogging, as you can probably figure out. That being said, it doesn't require very precise tolerances to function, so you can certainly try printing it using fusion deposition modeling, that is, traditional 3D printing. I can't guarantee it'll work more than once, but it's worth a shot if you don't have a stereolithography, or SLA, machine. In any case, if you have the valve stem, whatever process you've used to make it, you can then attach the O-rings. Now, there are three O-rings that go on to the valve stem. Two of them are used as a sliding interface between the walls of the valve that prevents leakage when the valve is open, and the third one is the regular sealing O-ring that prevents leakage when the valve is closed. It may take a bit of artistry to bring the O-rings into their spots. I found that a small screwdriver is well suited for this. The two O-rings that are used as a sliding interface are the smaller O-rings, with an inside diameter of 5 mm and an outside diameter of 9 mm. These are all approximate. You may need an assortment of O-rings to try, especially since this is where the tolerances are very important. The O-ring that's used for sealing in the closed position is a single 6.5 millimeter inside diameter, 10.5 millimeter outside diameter O-ring. Now, once you attach the O-rings as seen here, you should be able to slide it into the first part of the valve body, which is actually constructed from a very specific brass fitting, a 1/4 inch NPT male to 1/4 inch hose barb adapter. I'm not going to show my preparation of this part, but to get the first part of the valve body, you must take this fitting, cut the barb off using whatever means at your disposal, and then drill a hole right down the center. The minimum diameter of this hole is 1/4 inch. It can be larger, that's not super important. You'll find that that's the diameter that lets the valve stem through. Now the inlet to this web shooter is a 1/8 inch NPT female inlet. So the first thing you'll want to do is figure out what's going to go into that inlet. Typically, I have a tube. So I need some kind of adapter between this tube and a 1/8 inch NPT male fitting so that it can go into the female fitting. Don't ask me how babies are made. Here I've used a compression fitting, which I've talked about in my videos in the past. It's a good one. You could also use a hose barb, but whatever floats your boat. Whatever container you have or tubing that goes to your container, just make sure you have a 1/8 inch NPT male fitting on the end, however you want to accomplish that. So you'll take that 1/8 inch NPT male fitting, wrap Teflon tape around it to seal it, and screw it into the 1/8 inch NPT to 1/4 inch NPT reducer. The 1/8 inch NPT female part of this reducer is the inlet. The 1/4 inch NPT female side of this reducer gets screwed onto the other part of the valve body, which we just prepared before. Before we do that, however, we want to place our main valve spring inside the valve. Now, my more recent web shooters have the spring on the outside, and that's a lot more convenient, but it is harder to build. So this older model has a spring on the inside. You might be able to try this spring from McMaster. But basically, you'll just want to use a spring that has about 1/4 inch overall length and about 1/4 inch overall diameter. Anything around that size should work. You'll just want to find something stiff enough that it returns the valve to its closed position. If you need to cut a spring to do this, that's fine too. So once our spring is inside, it's time to close up the valve body. So you'll take that other part of the valve body that we prepared from the hose bar before, wrap Teflon tape around the male fitting to seal it, and then screw it into the 1/4 inch NPT female side of the reducer. Now, how much you tighten this is important. You'll need to look at the 3D printed lower body part. You'll see there's a mating surface for the reducer and the hex part of the hose barb that we drilled a hole through. This cylindrical surface corresponds to the area where the Teflon tape is left uninserted into the reducer. So you'll want to screw it in so that it fits this profile. Then the valve should work just fine. Now that the valve is ready, we can continue mating it to the other 3D printed parts. First of all, the nozzle part of the valve stem can be inserted into the hole of the nozzle trigger face, like so. There's nothing required to fasten these two together. Then, that entire assembly can be placed into the lower body, and the upper body can be placed on top of it. Then you'll use two M2.5 screws to attach the upper body to the lower body, fastening the valve in place. These screws can be anywhere from 6 to 8 millimeters long. It's very important that you don't use all four screws at this point, because there's another part that those screws need to attach. You can now or at any point slide the tubing clamp around the tubing so that it attaches to the upper body. This is mainly done to guide the tubing out of the back of the web shooter. The next thing we're going to do is attach the trigger. This requires the two 15mm long M3 screws and the two M3 lock nuts. The attachment method is pretty straightforward, but don't tighten so much that friction starts to take over. The trigger should move pretty easily around its pivot point. It's similarly easy to attach the trigger plate to the levers using a 2mm diameter nail. This nail can be anywhere from 17 to 20 millimeters long. The next thing you'll want to do is insert a strong, stiff thread through the side port so that it comes out the top hole. You'll need to do this carefully, and it might take a couple tries. This is the thread that's going to activate the snap trigger mechanism so that your trigger can be deployed on command. You'll want to guide a spring around the thread on the side that comes out the top hole. There are some pen springs that may work for this, but if you're looking for an exact part, you can use this spring from McMaster. Once that spring is in place around the thread, you can attach the trigger snap latch. You can do that by guiding the thread through the small hole on the trigger snap latch and then tying it around. You may also want to glue or melt this in place. Now that the trigger snap latch is in place, you can place the trigger snap cover on top of it. It should be obvious how this is done, but it should be done in such a way such that when you pull the thread from the side port, the trigger snap latch moves inward. And then when the thread on the side port is released, the spring returns the trigger snap latch to its original position. There shouldn't be much friction here. If there is, you'll want to sand down some of your parts to eliminate it. Once the trigger snap cover is in place, you can use the remaining M2.5 screws to attach it, threading through the upper body into the heatset inserts in the lower body. Next, you can attach the elastic latex bands that will deploy our trigger. These can be cut from latex tubing, which you can buy on Amazon if you just search latex tubing. Cut a piece that's roughly a quarter inch in width and about 2 inches in length. You can play around with the width and the length if you want. You'll want to use thread forming screws. I got these at the hardware store. Anything with a diameter of about 2 millimeters should work fine. With these screws, poke a hole on either end of the latex band. Then attach it using these screws by threading them into the holes on the lever and on the lower body. You'll want to do this for both sides of the trigger. Next, we can take our smaller tubing and thread the thread coming out the side port through it. You should be able to pull the trigger snap latch by pulling the thread through this tube. You can insert the other end of this tube into the finger track, which I've attached a small band to wrap it around my index finger. Now before you do this next step, you'll want to make sure that the finger switch slides nicely into the finger track without any friction. If there's friction, you'll want to sand down both parts. Now move the finger switch to the proximal end of the finger track. That's closest to where the tube inserts into the finger track. Wrap the string coming through the hole around the capstan on the finger switch. After this is done, you can either tie it or melt it into place. I found that melting is a more surefire way. The next step is to glue the watch strap into the strap pivots. You can use whatever glue you like, but I prefer to use JB Weld for this particular task. Don't forget to make it look pretty. Once the glue is dry, your web shooter is complete. Go ahead and test it out. One of the first things I like about this web shooter is that the trigger can be deployed using a single hand. You have that nice finger switch around your index finger, and you can activate it with your thumb, which will pull the thread through the tube into the web shooter and retract the trigger snap latch, releasing the trigger, allowing the elastic bands to pull it into your palm. And then you can use the web shooter. I always liked this approach. Recently, of course, I'm using a bit more of an advanced solution to the palm trigger problem. But I always found this was pretty elegant, so I hope you enjoy it. And don't forget, there's a lot of information in my other videos about how to use web fluid with this web shooter. So don't go complaining in the comments.
So I hope you found that helpful. Feel free to ask questions in the comments below. Don't forget to leave a like to motivate me to finish my technical breakdown of this device, the most advanced web shooter in existence. You should pay close attention. Could be yours one day. Follow me on Instagram at the.amazing.labs for more frequent updates. Check out my Discord server, link in the description. And don't forget to support the inception of Dragline Dynamics by donating to me on Patreon or buying some of my merch from the store tab on my channel. Stay safe, stay amazing, and I'll see you hopefully next week.